ओम ज्ञानतिमिरांधस्य ज्ञानांजनशलाकया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। श्रीचैतन्यमनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूप कदा मह्यं ददाति स्वपदांतिकं। वंदेहं श्रीगुरुः श्रीयुतपदकमलं श्रीगुरुन् वैष्णवांश्च श्रीरूपं साग्रजातं सहगण रघुनाथान्वितं तं सजीवं साद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजन सहितं कृष्णचैतन्यदेवं श्रीराधाकृष्णपादां सहगणललिता श्रीविशाखान्वितांश्च। नम ओं विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदान्तस्वामिन्निति नामिने। नमस्ते सारस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्य देश तारिणे वांछाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपा सिंधुभ्य एव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर शिवासादि गौर भक्त वृंद। हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे। Thank you, Sanak Sanatan Prabhu, for inviting me to come here for this All India ISKCON Cow Conference. And thank you also for your many, many years of dedicated service to Mother Cow in the holy land of Sri Vrindavan Dham. So, this Cow Conference is very important, very interesting. Many, many topics have been discussed, and also they will be discussed tomorrow as well. So it's very nice that such a conference has been organized. I hope we will have more such seminars and conferences every year. So the topic for this part of the seminar is how to connect to Mother Cow in daily life, or how to come closer to Mother Cow in daily life. Now, if you ask most people, I'm speaking about people in general, not necessarily devotees, and if you ask them what their connection with Mother Cow is, most likely you will get the answer, milk. So it is because of milk that most people feel some kind of a connection to the cow. Now, most people who live around and who are probably watching this program now live in the urban areas, not in the rural areas. It is only in the rural areas, and not always but sometimes, that people have the opportunity to serve the cows, they rear cows, look after them, etc. In those living in the urban areas hardly have any opportunity to serve the cows like that, unless there is a goshala in the city, or there is a farm project or a goshala in the outskirts. So generally, when we think of cow, we think of milk. And even amongst devotees, somehow or the other, the equation of milk and cow is so strongly embedded that the moment we think of cow, we think of milk. Now, undoubtedly, cow's milk has many wonderful properties. The Shastras have described that milk, cow's milk, is like nectar. And it is very, very delicious as well. It's also very nutritious, as Srila Prabhupada has also confirmed. It's full of vitamins, minerals, and many, many other helpful ingredients that are good for our health. It gives us health, it gives us strength, it gives us vitality, it increases the duration of our life, it helps if administered by a good physician, it helps us to get rid of different kinds of ailments. And above all, as Srila Prabhupada has mentioned several times, it purifies the tissues of the brain, so that it It sharpens and purifies the intelligence and gives us some degree of spiritual inclination. So therefore, the glories of the milk of Mother Cow is extolled in many places in the scriptures, and one can verify that by practical experience as well. However, since most of us don't live on a farm and we live in the cities, we don't have any practical hands-on experience of serving the cows. We don't know what it means to be actually living with the cows, serving them, having some exchanges with them, etc. And you know the joke, and it's not unfortunately just a joke, it is also a reality, that if you ask school children in some of the cities as to where the milk comes from, most likely they will say it comes from a polythene bag or a milk bag. At the most, they may say it comes from the milk dairy, or it comes from the shopping mall. So the disconnect between Mother Cow and people at large is very strong. And the only connect that people find is milk. But even then, people are not aware of how the milk is extracted from the cow and how it happens to reach our doorstep where we consume it. So it is natural, therefore, that in the circumstances as it exists in the modern days, people think of the cow as some kind of a milk-giving machine. And even devotees to some degree have that tendency at the back of their mind. They are aware of how pure and holy Mother Cow is and about the glories of the milk, but they don't think much beyond the milk. Undoubtedly, as I mentioned, it is very wonderful. It's a life-giving tonic, the milk of Mother Cow. However, we are cautioned in the scriptures to not consider that cow is merely some kind of an animal that gives a machine that gives milk. So we find in the Puranas there is a nice verse in which the cow Nandini, who is a Kamadhenu cow who can give unlimited amounts of milk, she speaks to the great king Dilip, and she says, Na kevalam pasya prasutim, na kevalam payasa prasutim, nahi maam kamadudam prasannam. So she says that, you know, don't think of me only as a milk giving machine. Na kevalam payasa prasutim. So payasa means milk. So don't think of me only as an object that gives milk. Know for certain that I can fulfill all desires. So don't look at me only because you think you can get milk. There's much more that you can get from me. So as devotees, we know that the ultimate thing that we can get from Mother Cow is her blessings, which means that we will get the mercy and blessings of Lord Krishna. Because Mother Cow is so dear to Krishna, if we serve Mother Cow, love her, please her, then Krishna will be pleased. And when Krishna is pleased, he will shower his mercy upon us, and we will be blessed with love of Godhead, which is the ultimate goal of life. So this way, Mother Cow has many valuable things to give us. Milk is undoubtedly amongst the very, very valuable things. She can give cow dung, she can give cow urine, yes, and her male counterpart, the bull, can give us also much valuable labor in the field and so on. So, yes, we have to keep this in mind that Mother Cow is much more than a machine for giving milk. She is an instrument, she is a great devotee in the hands of Lord Krishna to give us mercy and blessings. So yes, certainly we can take the milk of the cow, That is what the scripture says. That is how the Brajavasis did. Krishna did it. But the question arises, who has the first right or the claim to the milk of the cow? It is the calf of the cow, not us. So if there is no calf, if the cow does not give birth to any calf, she will not give any milk. But how many of us, when we drink milk, or when we think of the cow, we think of the calf? Very few. It is our duty as cow lovers to also ensure that we are calf lovers. And it is our duty to ensure that the calf is not deprived of its rightful share of milk. We cannot simultaneously be cow lovers and then deprive the calf of its share of milk. That is a contradiction. It cannot happen. So now most people who live in the cities buy milk from the milkman, or perhaps you buy it from the shopping mall or the shop where it comes in packets, and it comes to those shops from some milk dairies which are running on a commercial basis. So for those of you who go to the neighborhood milkman, this tradition still exists in some parts. The milkman comes with his container and then he pours out the milk. And maybe you should start a conversation with him about whether the calves in his goshala are being adequately fed with milk, with the cow's milk. Or is it that he just gives very little milk to the calf and then takes away the calf and takes most of the milk from the cow so that he can sell it and make money? Is that the case? So it would be our duty as cow lovers, as devotees of Lord Krishna, to actually physically go and check it out. And then ensure, by putting pressure on the milkman, that he gives proper milk, sufficient milk to the calf. And actually we should explain to him why it is also in his interest to see that the calf is fed adequate milk. It's just common sense actually, and I'll come to it in a few moments. So the topic for today is how to connect to mother cow in daily life. So the approach I'm taking in this short talk today is we can connect to mother cow in daily life by ensuring that we connect to mother to baby calf. In my room I have these nice deities of mother cow. Mother cow, and the calf is drinking milk. Do you see? And very lovingly, the cow is, yes, this is the position. The cow is licking its calf. So this is a beautiful picture of the calf suckling the mother, and the mother is also reciprocating by licking the calf affectionately. So when the cow is jolly, when the cow is happy, when the cow is satisfied in every respect, then automatically she will happily give milk. It will not be an issue at all. And that is natural to see, because you see, when a mother is, when the mother is with the child feels happy and the mother feels happy. Some technical issue. Okay. Yes. So when the mother and child are together, naturally both become happy. Srila Prabhupada also in his purports mentions that when the cow and bull are kept joyful, then the entire human society can be joyful. So even if the milkman has to look at it from a selfish point of view of how much more milk I can get from the cow, he should understand that he can get more milk if he lets the calf drink more milk from the cow. Once the calf is with the mother and is sumptuously fed to its satisfaction, then the cow will give more, definitely, because she is happy and she will be grateful and she will give more milk. And not only will the cow give more milk in terms of quantity, but she will also give more milk in terms of quality. The quality of the milk will be extremely nice, pure, because it is given with devotion. Then when the calf grows up, if it's a female calf, then it will become a cow, a full-grown cow, and that cow will yield much more milk than other cows. And when this cow or this calf, if it's a male, when it grows up, if it becomes a breeding bull, then he will be a very good breeding bull. And if he is used for work on the farm, and then he also will be very, very productive, much stronger, with much more stamina, and he won't get fatigued, he won't fall sick. So just like even for humans, as any doctor, especially pediatricians, will tell you, the children who grow up drinking adequate amounts of mother's milk will become much healthier and stronger when they grow up. So it is with mother calf. So actually it is in the interests of the cow herder, of the milkman, etc., to ensure that the calf is kept happy by drinking adequate milk, the cow is kept happy by ensuring that the calf is not taken away from her, and that the calf is allowed to suckle for at least 8 to 10 months, which means anything from 250 to 300 days. You see, traditionally in India, the cows and bulls were considered members of the family of the farmer. They were looked after with great affection. And there is one story that I never tire of telling. And that is, and some of you may have heard it from me on some of the other occasion, that one time there was a big agricultural or dairy seminar and conference in New Delhi. And farmers from all over the country had been invited. So each state sent some selected farmers. So there was one farmer from the state of Maharashtra who also was there in a stall, and he had his bulls and so on, which he had brought along with him. And a minister in the government in Delhi, in the central government, he also visited this particular fair or exhibition, and he saw this farmer who was from the same state that he was from. So he went up to the farmer and started speaking to him and told him that, why are you so old-fashioned? You are still with bulls. Now you just let me know and I will arrange a loan for you so that you can buy a tractor. And then you can ply the tractor on your fields. So you can earn much more money. So would you like to do that? And the farmer said no. And the minister was curious. He asked why. And the farmer gave such a simple reply, but such a deep, profound, meaningful reply, that the minister was left speechless and he just simply walked away from there. What was the farmer's reply? The farmer's reply was, but the tractor will not be able to love me. So this goes to show that traditionally the cows and bulls lived with the farmer in the village, and the cows and bulls lived like members of the family. So just as the farmer looked after his children and relatives and so on, he also looked after the cows and bulls like that, and therefore they were kept healthy. The calves were also looked after like their own children. So they were not deprived of their rightful and adequate share of milk. So the calves became very healthy. And when they grew up, they became very strong cows or bulls and very, very productive. In this way, cow protection flourished. Agriculture also flourished. But today, unfortunately, we have commercial dairy farming, where the mentality is only commercial. So every time the calf drinks some amount of milk from the mother, the businessman or the dairy farmer will start calculating how much of a loss monetarily it will be for him. And he's just looking for the first opportunity at which he can take the calf away from the mother. And as soon, because the cow will not give milk unless the calf is near it, near her. So the calf is brought near the cow, it starts suckling for a while, and when the milk starts flowing, then the calf is immediately removed from the place and taken to another place. And then the dairy extracts as much milk as it can, and the calf may get very little milk, perhaps half a liter or something. And then when the calf is about 3 months old, then the calf is sold to another farmer or to a butcher or something like that, because the tender skin of the calves fetch a high price in the market. If somehow or the other the calf is fortunate enough to not have been sold for slaughter, then because of being very much underfed and malnourished, if it's a female, it will grow up being a cow that will give very less milk. And if it is a male, it will grow up being a bull or an ox also, who is not at all strong and healthy. So it will be very weak. So essentially, what we find is that once you neglect feeding the calf automatically, then the next generation of cows and bulls will become very weak. And then the further generation will also become weaker and weaker. So as a result of depriving a calf of its share of the milk at a given point in time, what we are effectively doing is we are weakening successive generations of cows and bulls. So just imagine the consequences of what we are doing. And actually, if you want the calf to be healthy and the cows and bulls in later stage of life to become very strong, then we must ensure that the calf is given milk of its mother in adequate quantity for at least 8 to 10 months. And if you do it for less than 100 days, if you separate the calf from the mother, then it will be very ruinous for the basic health of the calf. And even if you give very good fodder and grass to the calf, it will not be an adequate substitute for mother's milk. Mother's milk ultimately is mother's milk. And then what will happen is that the generations to come will become weaker, and the milk yield will also become lesser and lesser as the time goes by. So the old records, government records, and also the records of historians who have, from here and also from other countries, shows that the indigenous breeds of cows in India would give much larger quantities of milk than they give today. There are some breeds of cows in those days that would give as much as 15 to 40 liters of milk per day. And that is after the calves had been fed properly. And today we find a struggle in most breeds, indigenous breeds of cows, to get even a few liters from the cows. So therefore we can see that it is not a wise practice at all. It is penny wise, pound foolish, as the proverb goes. For short-term gain and profit, to deprive the calf of the milk and then suffer such long-term consequences. But the modern dairy farming industry, they maximize the quantity of milk by artificial and cruel means. And therefore, the whole issue of cow protection has become such a problematic issue now. So, what has happened is, because the calves, especially the bull calves, are being sold to the slaughterhouse, maybe after 3 months or sometimes lesser than that, at lesser ages than that, the population of calves has rapidly fallen down, and so has the population of cows and bulls all over the country. And therefore, what is happening? So today, we have a milk crisis, we have a milk product crisis, people are adulterating milk, they are giving all sorts of fake substitutes for milk. It's a big crisis that people are not recognizing. And this is because we are not following Lord Krishna's model. So if we do this, then we will ensure that everything will prosper. If the calf is happy, the cow is happy, the bull will be happy, human society will be happy, everything will be prosperous, everything will flourish. So, today's talk, therefore, is dedicated to the calf. So let us connect to the calf. So let us speak on behalf of the calf. Let us remember the calf. Let us work in the interests of the calf. Let us try to ensure in various ways that the calf is not deprived of its rightful share of milk. Even in goshalas, this may be the case. In goshalas where the cows are kept to protect them from being slaughtered, even sometimes perhaps when the cows are being looked after by very devoted people, but the actual handlers of the cows may not have that concept. So what happens is that even in such goshalas, the calves are actually getting deprived of the rightful share of milk. So I thought that today I would like to focus on this point. It's not a point that is often discussed. Generally, when we speak of connecting to mother cow in daily life, when we're living in the city, then we can talk of, say, the various medicines that we can use to connect to mother cow, or we can talk of many other types of products that can be used. And undoubtedly, these are very wonderful things which we certainly can use, and we can use them as substitutes for our other commercial chemical-based or plastic-based products. But we must keep in mind that ultimately the root here lies with the calf. So there are many projects that Srila Prabhupada started, farm community projects. Some of them are still there, and some of them started after Srila Prabhupada's departure, and in several of them the devotees are working hard and they're looking after the cows nicely, and they are making sure that the calf is adequately fed from its mother, and that is going on. So I can think of so many projects, and there are also some other projects which may not be temple based but which are also flourishing. Of course, I can think of so many, actually I don't want to mention, but as far as privately based projects, I can think of one nice place in Melbourne in Australia which is called Mother Cow Dairy, which is run by some devotees, and they are connected to a local farmer, and they have made a deal with the farmer that they will buy all the milk from a particular herd of cows, provided the cows, the bulls and the calves are looked after according to certain conditions that we lay down. And one of the very important conditions is that the calves should get the milk to their full satisfaction. They should not be deprived of any milk, and only after the calf has been adequately fed, then the remaining milk can certainly be taken for human consumption. So the next time you drink milk, the next time you go to the milkman, or then perhaps you can even start writing letters to the various places that you're buying milk from, to put pressure on them to ensure that they give adequate milk to the calf. And that is how you will connect to Mother Cow, and also definitely you will please Lord Krishna and Srila Prabhupada. So, Go Mata Ki Jai. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna Maharaj, thank you so much for your wonderful talk and friendship, Guruji. And I remember one thing very clearly, when I started here in Vrindavan, you said that if you take care of the Gokshala nicely, the temple will flourish. And yes, actually the temple is flourishing very well, because Shubha Krishna, whole team is here taking care of the cows. So thank you, Maharaj, for participating, and what pronouns.
Hare Krishna, thank you very much. Hare Krishna.
So our next speaker will be Revati Ram.